Audit and Governance Subcommittee 24th November 2014. We have any apologies for our absence? Where that peer review was. John be able to give us a about addressing issues of the PPU from 2012. I've got Councillor Stockton there to ask a question. Councillor McGrath first.
Thanks, Jim. John, you mentioned we have a scrutiny committee. We used to, since we've been mentioning with combined law policy, they have the scrutiny committee. We now have the performance review committee. So, just to be a little counting, sorry.
Thank you,
Jim.
Thanks, Chair.
Councillor
Stockton, we're extremely thorough.
one form of self-assessment, and the actions that have been identified, and an action plan on page 27 and 28. Those are the actions that we need to now address to be fully compliant with the requirements. I'm not intending to go through them in any great detail, but you can see yourselves that the main points there are that we need to develop the quality assurance and improvement programme. And they also need to make some provisions to the audit charter, to our counter fraud strategy, and then also make relevant changes to the procedures and internal manual accordingly. The revised charter and the draft quality assurance and improvement programme will come back to this subcommittee. And I'm aiming to have those back to you to see in the next meeting in January 2015. I'm happy to take questions on the action plan, but before I pass back to the chair, the second element of this report really is to start looking ahead, if we can, to how we'll undertake the external assessment. Now, obviously, I've said already that we're required to do that at least every 5 years. We're already 2 years into the standards now, so we do need to be looking ahead. I attend, as the head of audit at Merseytravel, I attend a regional group, the Northwest Chief Audit Executives Group. That's attended by most of the heads of audit, across the Northwest area in the public sector. That group collectively have come up with a proposal where we could peer review each other's self-assessments. We have had that checked by CIPFA, that it would be appropriate for us to undertake the external assessment in that manner. And the benefit, of course, is that it would be cost neutral. I would undertake the external assessment with my colleagues, and vice versa, another colleague would undertake ours. At the minute, this is just a principle. It's an idea that we're putting to yourselves as the audit group and subcommittee for your thoughts. If you are in support of us to address the external assessment in that way, then what we'll do is put together a more formal approach and bring that back to you for your proper approval. But basically, it's just so we can throw our hat in the ring and say, yes, we'll progress with the group in that respect, or no, we won't. But should just make you aware that should we not, we have heard that external assessments from third-party providers can be anywhere in excess of £15,000 to have that undertaken. So it's quite a pricey process. But obviously, I'm handing over to you really for your thoughts on that. If you'd like us to progress with that, there's a lot of us to get some information from the provider. So I'm happy to take questions on either of those.
Thank you, Steph.
This is a very sensible proposal, but I have a bit anxious about it. So it strikes me that, and please correct me if I'm wrong, it strikes me that if it's just two parties marking each other for assessing each other externally, potential for conflict of interest, what might work, and this is the purpose of the stupid model, but what might work if that is the conflict is how people would be prepared to share their time.
Thanks for that, Councillor Gore. In terms of the actual approach, if you imagine that there's 30 of us, what we're intending to do is draw up a way of independently determining who will do each person's review. We would have to declare any interest, so any relationships that I have with specific authorities, for example, I used to work for St Helens, so it would be inappropriate for St Helens to undertake a review of me and vice versa. So we would have to declare that. But also, whichever review I do, they would not do theirs. So it wouldn't be a mutual reciprocal arrangement, it would be from the pool. But you're absolutely right to raise that, it's something we do need to think quite carefully. I know that other regions are taking this approach, and they're doing it in Scotland. So what we will need to do is formalise the manner in which we'll make those selections, and that will have to be properly documented, and we'll need to consider that properly before we progress. You are absolutely there to raise it, but we are aware of that. And it may be that we decide to do it in pairs even, just to try and get that properly defined. To make the external assessment work well, that has to be done properly, so we need to consider all of that. Right now, we're just at that early stage, really, where we're looking at it as an option, particularly as well, because we're aware that some of the other parts of the country are taking this approach. But then we need to look into how we'll actually do it.
progress made to date in respect of ensuring compliance with the public sector and technology standards. Request a further update of the violence of this subcommittee and approve engagements with the North West Chief Performance Executive Group as the public sector and technology standards. External assessment body for Merseytravel subject to submission of a formal framework to this subcommittee and formal improvement of appointments in due course. Can I agree? Item 6 is set the code of practice on managing the risk of fraud and corruption. There's some changes to set the code of practice.
Thank you, Chair. In fact, this is a new code of practice that's been published by SIPA, but it's literally just come out in October of this year. The reason that I have that I'm presenting this to you today is really for information at this stage so that you're aware of this guidance. What we understand is that further guidance is to come now on how we should actually interpret and implement the code. Just to advise members, it's not statutory at this stage, but it's best practice, and there's no, obviously, knowing that it will become statutory in the future, so it's better for us to be taking ahead now. But also, we're offering the action plan on the public sector and internal audit standards that we need to revise and update our counter fraud strategy anyway, so therefore it makes sense to do it in line with some inclusion practice. At this stage, we're not intending to take any action though until we receive that additional guidance from SIPA. So really it's more about briefing members today, making you aware of this new code of practice and that this is something that we're working with. Although I'm happy to answer any questions, the guidance itself, the code of practice itself, is attached to page 33 for your reference. Yes, Chair.
Thank you, Chair. Just to add to that, SIPA's offered, well, we've taken the training with SIPA for all members in the committee on 3rd December.
But what
investigate that. There are boundaries on them. But you're absolutely right to say that in the majority of, I think, all cases, you have to undertake an investigation in order to assess its legitimacy.
Chair. Go ahead.
When we worked upon this document, we looked at the current legislation, the case law around it, these were words that were used in the policies. And I think Steph's right, you'd investigate certain things to point for merged cases and then to the general principle of the advice. But like Steph says, you should have to say, you have to have that, but then serious question about how that's generally played as being developed or actions. So there's a reality test at the very early stages of these processes. However, most of these are some investigation to determine the policies.
Sure, I just come to that because authorities and private organisations just need questions on a daily basis. And it's a waste of public resources to investigate things that have in those sorts of things. Whereas we have an issue where it's genuine and the substitutes for maybe aware to raise.
Yeah, you investigate, I have to see if it's
try to look at future meetings of audits and governance and performance review committees. When held on the same day, each should be seen as advertising of that board.
Yes, Chair.
Yeah, absolutely. That's